Gracious Lord, as our Savior spent time in the wilderness, so we too prepare to go into our own world of wilderness. Be with us, Lord. Liven our hearts. Help us to feel your presence walking with us. Help us, Lord, always return to your presence. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. The reason I extended that gospel reading this morning is very simple. No matter when you believe that Jesus Christ absolutely, positively knew who he was, that indeed he was the Son of God, almost universally scholars will accept that this moment after our Lord's baptism, that Jesus felt, knew, and absolutely understood that indeed he was the Messiah. That he was the one true God, that he was the Son of God. And in this ancient world, there are a few things that I want to share with you that the ancient people feared almost more than anything else. Ancient people of this time and this place feared the waters, the seas, the big lakes, the Sea of Galilee. They believed that these places contained evil spirits because of the waves that occurred and the unnatural currents that occurred. And they believed that because humans can control those tides or those waves, that it must have been the forces of evil that controlled them. That same kind of feeling the ancient world believed about the wilderness. You and I can know a little bit about that if any of you have spent any time in the woods in the middle of a dark night. Every noise you hear, you think is a bear lurking behind the tree. The ancients understood that in the wilderness, evil things were allowed to exist, and that they had little control over. So this morning, in this gospel reading that we had for us today, you have this absolute clash of feelings. This uplifting moment when Jesus hears the voice of God saying, "This is my Son, my beloved, listen to him." And then immediately out into the wilderness with you, where our Lord faces his own fears, his own kinds of trials, his own temptations. When a person comes to have fear and allow fear to consume them, we can often forget the basic patterns of our lives and try to do all kinds of things to bring about our own personal security and our own acceptance. While I am not a psychological major, I will tell you that for most people, our identity is formed by the family we keep, by the family that we're formed in, by the friends that we hang around with, because in these families, in these friendships, you and I are taught how to live and thrive in the world. And there are all these natural laws that exist within these family units that don't need to be written down because we know them to be true because everyone around us is doing it. Indeed, our Lenten pilgrimage will allow us to face fears. Perhaps we would be wise to remember in whose family, where our identity is shaped and formed and felt, we actually belong. During our Lenten pilgrimage, you might actually have fear that somehow your very souls are dependent upon your success of being and displaying the proper piety during these next 40 days. You may have fear that this year you may falter just like in years past and not get the most out of this season of Lent. In fact, in many ways, our Lent pilgrimage in and of itself can become its own temptation for us before the world even gets involved. Our Lent journey may be a time in which you and I are tempted to prove to ourselves and to God that we are worthy of God's love because of the way we live and the things that we do. We may use our time in this Lent journey to prove to others that I am more worthy of God's love than you are because I do a better job of praying and fasting and reading the Holy Scripture. That temptation might be to insist that my individual path, my individual pilgrimage towards the cross of Jesus Christ outside of Jerusalem matters more than how I might walk with others in the world. Yet, this text haunts us. This text of Jesus being in the wilderness and facing his own temptations, it absolutely haunts us. For you see, Jesus already knew that he was the Son of God. Jesus already knew that he belonged to God. And to make matters worse, Satan knew that he was talking to the Son of God. So the questions that Satan asks, the trials that Satan causes, come because Satan wants to make sure that Jesus feels it in his heart that our Lord and Savior knows who he is, to whom he belongs. And so Jesus' time in the wilderness allow him to fact-check himself in order that he would be prepared for the many temptations that he would face on the road to Jerusalem. Perhaps you and I could look at this season of Lent in the same way. We could look at Lent perhaps this year and think of it as our annual car inspection. You know, when you take your car to a mechanic and the mechanic has a checklist and to make sure that your wiper blades are working, that your lights are working, that your engine is running the way it's supposed to. We could look at this season as a time in which we are basically doing an annual inspection of our own hearts and our own lives in the way and the manner in which we are called to live them. Because so many times we say things that then we don't follow through with. So let's take a look at that this morning. In the waters of your baptism, or at a time that you confirmed your faith, any time you went through an affirmation of your baptism, you said that you would live among God's faithful people, that you would come to the Word of God and attend God's Holy Supper. That's coming to church. That's being within your family. But not just on Sundays, but through the week. That's understanding your identity as part of a larger whole. The community of faith that God gives to us all. To surround us and support us in times of trial and in times of joy. You said that you would know the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments. And you said that you would read Holy Scripture. These are disciplines of Lent. Yet they're disciplines of the disciples' life. They become part and parcel of who we are. Not just on a Sunday morning, but in the daily routine of our days. You said that you would proclaim Christ through both word and deed. That means that when you're around people who do you harm, that you offer them a word of forgiveness and peace instead of a word of retaliation. That means that when your heart hurts because someone has hurt you, that you don't intentionally go out to hurt that person. Proclaiming Christ through word and deed is to see the person standing next to you that's in great need. And instead of just feeling sorrow in your heart, that you actually do something to help that person in need. That understanding of proclaiming Christ through word and deed is to know who you say you are and who you say this Jesus Christ that's in the wilderness is. And actually allowing that to pervade your life, but to allow yourself to be open to the thoughts and the ideas and opinions of the person next to you. Because intrinsically, our God says each and every value, each and every life has intrinsic value. You said that you would care for others. and the world around us. That you would do something instead of just sitting on your hands. That when you see people in pain, that you would aid them in their time of suffering. You said that you would work for justice and peace. That when you see someone else's value being diminished, whether it's by politics or laws or words or expressions of exclusion, that you would raise your voice to be a voice for the voiceless. You said that you would bring about peace. A peace that comes from understanding your own intrinsic value. A peace that comes from knowing that you yourself are a loved child of God. Without promoting peace through violence. You see, there are so many temptations in this world. And most of them don't come to us in the form of that bright, shiny apple hanging from the tree of good and evil. Rather, those temptations come from the subtle messages that seek to undermine our identity, and they invite us to forget to whom we belong. There are so many commercials on television that seek to suggest that you and I are inadequate just the way we are. There are so many headlines on the news that suggest that there just simply isn't enough of anything to go around the world. That there aren't enough cars, there isn't enough food, there's not enough beauty to go around the world. There are so many politicians, and politicians on both sides of this aisle, that contend that we have everything in this world to fear. That behind every corner lurks someone willing to take our life. In the face of these identity obscuring messages, you and I have this season of Lent. A time when we allow ourselves to be rooted in a baptismal promise that we are safeguarded and empowered by our Lord Jesus Christ to serve as a beacon of lights in the dark world. Each one of you, in those times of affirmation, promised that you would renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God. What does that look like for you? Maybe it's that overweight child in middle school that everyone is picking on. But instead of being worried about being accepted by your own friends, you offer a word to say, that person is beautiful just the way they are. Maybe the way we say, go so long, Satan, is by looking at people whom we work with that think it's okay to cheat and abscond with money and say, my Lord and Savior doesn't allow us to do that. You and I promised that we would rebel against the powers of this world that take us away from God. That we would raise our voices in unison, even in the political arena, when we see injustices occurring, where one human life is devalued in favor of another. We said that we would rebel against those things in this world that take us away from God when we allow our own hearts to be moved by people around us who tell us that someone else isn't as good as you are because of the color of the skin that they have, or the way in which they live their life, or the God in which they believe. You and I both promise that we would all renounce the ways of sin that draw us away from God. Those times in our lives when we don't feel as if we have enough. And so we work and we do things duplicitous to get those things we need. We elevate ourselves and hurt someone else so that we can show the world that we're better than that person. in all these ways. We break our own baptismal covenant with our God. Lent gives you and I an opportunity to look at our lives, to see ourselves standing naked in the mirror in front of God, and to check, to see whether we're actually living the life we promised we would live in the presence of God. Each one of you are loved. Each one of you are valued. Each one of you are accepted in the presence of the Lord, just as you are right now. Extend that same gift to the world around you. And in your times of trial, turn to Jesus. Allow Jesus to walk this path with you.